So last spring, the Maine legislature passed a bill to weaken the state's mining regulations. This change could pave the way for open pit mines in areas of Maine with sulfide deposits that contain copper, nickel, zinc, or other metals. Now, where are these deposits? Well, at Bald Mountain in the heart of the forests of northern Maine, under Moosehead Lake, along the coast, particularly down east, and more places than most of us realize. Mining companies make big promises, lots of jobs, and minimal environmental impacts. But NRCM thinks the realities may be much harsher, and we are deeply concerned about what comes next. Ramsey Hart is the Canada Program Coordinator for Mining Watch Canada, and he is here tonight to help us understand the possible costs and consequences of open pit mining in Maine. Ramsey understands the land and river systems and climate of our part of the world because he lived for several years right across the border in New Brunswick. An ecologist by training, he has evaluated mining proposals and operations from New Brunswick to British Columbia. He has worked closely with communities and First Nations whose local economies, lands, and water resources could be affected by mines. Like NRCM's own staff, Ramsey focuses much of his energy on policy and legal reform and on watchdogging the government's handling of mining regulations. In other words, he talks our talk. Now, before I bring Ramsey up, I also want to bring up Nick Bennett, who is NRCM's staff scientist and has had to relearn and bone up on mining ever since this all started to come down. So he'll be available on stage after Ramsey's talk to answer any questions that are really Maine specific. So may I invite them both up to the stage?
How's that working, Bert? We're good? Okay. Well, thanks very much, everybody, for coming tonight and for the invitation to visit you in Maine. It's my first proper visit to the state, and it's having lived and left my heart in New Brunswick, it very much feels like a bit of a homecoming. It's good to be somewhere where the dress code is more about check and plaid than drab suits, as it is in Ottawa. Congratulations to all the award winners. Great to see so much good work happening here in the state of Maine. So I'm going to be speaking for about 20 minutes. I've probably got about 2 hours worth of material to try and cram into 20 minutes. So I'll be skipping over some pretty detailed and complex issues, but hopefully we'll have time for some conversation both tonight and then also well into the future, as I don't think this is the last time we'll be working together. And not only am I a staff of Mining Watch, I'm also the chair of the steering committee for a Canada-US-wide network of mining activists and technical people and affected community members in what in Canada we call First Nations and what you call in the States Native Peoples, which reminds me to acknowledge the fact that it's good to be here in Wabanaki on Penobscot territory. Back home, we always like to acknowledge the First Peoples on whose land we're walking. So Mining Watch Canada, without getting into too much detail, just so you have a bit of a sense of who we are, we're Canada's national advocacy group focused exclusively on mining. We're a very small group for a big country with a lot of mines. There's five of us. And not only do we cover Canada, but we also work internationally. So the picture at the top right, which is maybe a little bit small for you to see, but that's of a acute mining conflict that was occurring in Ecuador when a group of armed thugs tried to displace local community members opposing a Canadian-owned copper project. And Canada is actually a world player, especially in terms of small junior mining companies. Most of the world's small junior mining companies have their base in Canada, and so that's a big part of our work as well. So why are we talking about mining tonight? The reason is, as you heard earlier, there is a proposed project that's a little bit further along than others up at Bald Mountain, but also potential for other projects throughout the state and all of those yellow areas that you see. And those yellow areas that you see on the map are the sulfide mineral deposits where potentially there could be valuable exploitable mineral resources. In the bottom left, you see an example of a sulfide mineral deposit. What is sulfide mining? Well, it's not a term we really use back home in Canada too much. It's sort of a catch-all term to refer to the mining of mineral bodies that are mostly iron sulfide, but also happen to contain traces of copper, zinc, sometimes gold, or silver. And these mines might be open pit or they might be underground. In the case of Bald Mountain, they're talking about an open pit development, like the one you see on the left. Now, one of the things I always try and convey to people when they're first trying to get their head around mining is the fact that mining really is a waste management industry. And the reason I say that is because the ores that we're typically mining today for base metals, it's even less so if you want to talk about gold or silver, but for base metals like copper and zinc, the ore concentrations are probably about 1 or 2% of the ore body. And the ore body is the rock that contains that commercial amount of mineral. Overlying an ore body, usually you have a whole lot of other rock that has to be moved out of the way, and that's what we call waste rock. And so this diagram, I'm trying to get across visually the fact that in order to mine, let's say, a ton of copper, you're going to have probably 198 tons of waste that is created. Okay. So mining very much becomes about managing all of that waste. This is one of the types of waste. This is the waste rock. And this is solid material that's blasted to get at the valuable ore body. It's then trucked and stacked and piled, usually on a land mass, recreating hills and creating topography that never existed before. Doing over the course of a few months or years what nature might do over millennia. The other type of mine waste are the tailings, and this is the result of taking the valuable part of the rock, the ore, grinding it up to very small sand and smaller size particles, and then running it through complex systems to extract the valuable minerals. It is then typically piped as a slurry and then dumped into a tailings impoundment or a pond. And this is what you end up with afterwards. This is an open pit mining site from British Columbia. It's a site that's been reactivated but was abandoned for a time, and you can see the pits have started to fill up with water. But it results in a fairly substantial scar on the landscape. Managing all of these wastes would be a challenge just because of their volume. We're talking about hundreds of millions of tons of material that is moved around at a mining operation. And just finding a place to store that and put that would be a challenge just by the very physical nature of all of that material. But while this is, in a sense, natural material, it is of natural origin, most of this material has never before seen the light of day or been exposed to the atmosphere or been exposed to rainwater or exposed to bacteria, which radically change the chemistry of the rock. Remember, we talk about sulfide deposits. Well, the sulfide in the iron sulfide, when it's exposed for the first time to the atmosphere and to rainwater and to bacteria, goes from being a fairly inert material locked in the Earth's crust to turning into sulfuric acid. That sulfuric acid then liberates large quantities of toxic metals like cadmium and lead into the water and potentially into the environment. On the right, you can see a dramatic picture of what's called acid mine drainage. The red color coming from that iron that's in the iron sulfide mineral depositing out in an oxidized form onto the riverbed. Though dramatic looking, that iron is actually the least problematic part of the equation. The pH being so low and those toxic metals like cadmium and lead and others are actually what's really of concern with acid mine drainage. This process can happen with sulfide deposits that are a few percent. The information that we've got, the little information we've got about Bald Mountain, suggests the sulfide content of Bald Mountain may be 40 to 50% sulfides. That means what you've got in those minerals is a toxic time bomb that has to be looked after forever once it's exposed to the atmosphere and to water and to those bacteria. Lesson in history, you've got a few of your own experiences with sulfide mining in Maine, but one example I like to point out the potential impact of poorly managed mining in British Columbia was a very small three-year operation on Vancouver Island that by today's standards was a minuscule mine and only operated for a short time, but generated enough acid mine drainage from the waste rock to completely wipe out the salmon from the Solom River. And salmon are to British Columbia what a moose and brook trout are to Maine, and lobster, I suppose, too. Culturally, ecologically, and economically, a vital, vital resource. And it's taken many years, millions of dollars, both donations and public funding to restore that river back to a point where the salmon are starting to come back. And what did that was predominantly the copper. Copper and salmonids, trout and salmon, do not mix well together. And we can get into the biology of that later. Fascinating work going on about how the copper affects the sense of smell of salmon and trout and affects their ability to sense danger because they actually communicate through chemical releases in the water. And when a fish smells that chemical, it reacts very differently. It will hide underneath and seek shelter if there's danger nearby. Adding copper to the water in very, very, very small amounts completely wipes out that response. And there's a variety of other potential impacts from the metals as well. We heard earlier about two very passionate talks about Maine, about how there are few places like it left and how they aren't making any more of them. Well, that's especially true when you talk about fish habitat. And this map on the right is a map of quality brook trout habitat, which is shown in the yellow and the green. And where do you find the best remaining brook trout habitat anywhere in its American native range is in the Maine North Woods. And it's not just the metals that are potentially toxic to brook trout and other aquatic organisms. It can also be the processing chemicals that are used, things like xanthates and thiosalts. It can also be changes in the water levels that come with mining. So how do you get around all of these potentially hazardous materials, and how do you manage all of this waste at a mine site?